So I want to tell you about a letter I got a little while ago that I only just got around to reading. Actually, it was in 2003 that it arrived, but I only just found it on the floor. My study is very messy. So the author is a contributor to the OEIS, a former contributor, I think I have to say, called Claude Lenormand. He suggested two transformations of sequences. His second transformation that introduced a word I didn't know, in a French word called un rabot. This is un rabot, a carpenter's plane. And his transformation is to take a sequence or a word, a string of numbers, and plane them down. Raboter, planing the sequence. What you plane down are the runs in a sequence. If we have a sequence, you might be tossing a coin, and you might get heads, heads, tails, 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 heads, tails. You look at the runs. Here we've got a run of two heads, so we get a two. We write down the length of the runs, three, one, one. So the runs transformation of a string, a sequence, is the lengths of the runs. That's the runs transformation. What the plane does, it shortens all the runs by one term. So if we had a run of three things, in the transform thing, we've got a run of two things. So we shorten all the runs. That's the operation of rapporter. So you remember in one of the earlier Numberphile videos you did, you mentioned a sequence of my old friend Sol Galom. And this is distinguished by the fact that it's a sequence of numbers. It's the, has the property that there, it's an increasing, well, I should say, non-decreasing sequence. It keeps growing, and it has the property that if you look at the run's length, you get the same sequence. All right, I'll just do a couple of terms. One, two, two. How do we continue? Galom's sequence, the one means the first run has length one. So we start off with a run of length one, and then we've got a run of some other numbers. And you always pick the smallest number. So the next number has to be a two. That two says the second run has length two. So we've got two twos. And now that two, which is the third term, says the third run has length two. So so it continues 3, 3, and then 4, 4, 4, 5, 5, 5. This will probably make it clearer. So this two refers to those two. The third term is two, and that says the third run of successive identical terms has length two. Well, okay, we've got our first run, our second run, our third run has to have length two. So that means we've got two threes. The fourth term, and that says the next run has length three. So there are going to be three fours. That three says three fours. This three says, aha, three fives.
So there'll be four sixes.
There are going to be four sixes. Very good. And there are going to be four sevens from that four. And that four says there are going to be four eights. And that five says there are going to be five nines. That's the defining property. It's non-decreasing. You always put down the smallest number you can, and it must be its own runs transformation. So that's Galom's sequence. Now, if we apply the Rabot to it and we plane it down, what are we going to do? Well, we're going to cross off that one. We've got two twos, so we throw away one of them. We've got two threes, we throw away one of them. We've got three fours, we throw away one, five. We just shorten all the runs. We apply the plane, le rabot. And what we get, the new sequence, is simply 2, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6, 6, 6, 7, 7, 7, and so on. So this is the planed down version of Galom's sequence. In Claude's letter, he gave the example of the Galom sequence and how to raboter it. So I thought it would be very interesting to apply the plane, le rabot, to the numbers, to the ordinary numbers written in binary. Now remember, the rule is when you plane it down, if it's got a run of length one, it goes away. So zero, well, becomes zero. So we get zero. One goes away and we get zero. One goes away, zero goes away, and we get zero. One, one becomes one in base two, which is one in base 10. So our new sequence is what you get when you plane down the numbers. So we get 0, 0, 0. This is the base 2 version. This is the base 10 version. So 1, 0, 0, we lose the 1, and we shorten that 0, and we get 0. 1, 0, 1, 0. Base 2 is 0, base 10 is 0. Here, now finally, we get something interesting. We lose the 0, and we lose a 1. So we get 1. Here, 1, 1, 1, we lose the 1. We've got 1, 1, which is 1, 1, which is 3. So the sequence that we're going to get goes 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 3. This one, we lose that and that, and we get 0. This, we lose the 1 and that, and we get 0. And 10, we lose everything. And 11, we lose that, that, and that, and we get 1. 12, we lose a 1 and a 0. And finally, we get a 2. We're doing 13. We lose that and that and that, and we get a 1. Because 12 is 1, 1, 0, 0, it becomes 1, 0, which is 2. 13, which is 1, 1, 0, 1, we lose the 1, the 0, and one of the 1s, and all we are left with is a 1. When we get to 14, we lose a 0 and a 1, and we're left with 1, 1, which is 3. And 1, 1, 1, 1, which is 15, we lose the 1, we get 1, 1, 1, and we get 7. And when we get down to 16, we get 0 again. So that's, and we keep going forever. So this is the plane down version. This has a very nice sound. You know, you can listen to any of the 300,000 sequences in the OEIS, and I would like to play this sequence for you.
How have you turned it into music?
We imagine that we have a grand piano, that's the basic thing, and we number the keys, 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 87. It's got 88 keys. And we take the number and we divide by 88 and keep the remainder, reduce it, mod 88. So that gives us something we can play on the grand piano. So if there are these numbers, you can see, are all pretty small. So it stays down here at the bottom of the keyboard for quite a long time, until we get up to some very big numbers before we actually have to round them down.
Why do you like that piece of music?
Yeah, why do I like it? Well, it has that rhythm to it. It goes da 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 pum, da 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 pum, da 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 pum. And those repetitions are because of the binary expansion. And then every so often, like at powers of 2 minus 1, we get a bigger number. And before it, we get some other big numbers. So there's a rhythm. So the sounds reflect the structure of the binary numbers, but processed. It's not just the straight binary numbers.
Neil, as you keep planing the binaries, obviously we were staying pretty low there with those numbers. Yeah. Do you start eventually getting some big numbers when you turn them into, you know, base 10?
Yeah, certainly. When we got up to, say, 2 to the 20 minus 1, plane off 1, we get 19 ones in a row. So eventually we get all the... Does every number appear? Yeah, sure. Okay, so there's an inverse operation, which is extending all the runs by one bit. And that works for any number.
What's that called? If that's La Robote, what do you call the other version where you add?
I just called it expanding. Claude didn't mention it in his letter, but obviously you could do it. You expand all the runs by one. And then if you applied his operation, you'd get back to where you started, so you can get every number. So a question is, after you've planed down a number, how big is it? What's the average value after you plane it down? So I looked at that and I asked some friends for help, and they proved my conjecture is correct. If n is k bits long in binary, in other words, if it's a k-bit number. So for instance, here are all the 3-bit numbers. There are actually 4 of them. A 3-bit number beginning with 1, of course, apart from 0. Every binary number begins with 1. So we could have 100 all the way up to 111. So there are 2 to the k minus 1. 3-bit numbers, there are 2 squared numbers, there are 4 of them. What's the average value? Well, it happens to be we had 4 numbers whose sum is 4, so the average value afterwards is 1. So what happens for a k-bit number? I conjectured that the average value after is exactly 3/2 to the power k minus 2 minus 1/2. And the way I found that was I worked out the average. You can see I just worked out the average for 3-bit numbers and I got 1. If you do that for the first 20 or 30 terms, you get a sequence. What do you do when you get a sequence? You look it up in the OEIS, and it is sequence A27649, which is the integer 3/2 to the k minus 1 minus 1/2. So the answer to this question, how big is what you get? It's about 3/2 to the k. So n was about 2 to the k, and we shrunk it down to 3/2 to the k. So that's the answer.
You might remember these pieces of pie we shared with Numberphile supporters a while back. Well, they were so popular, we've now created these unique views of our beloved Mandelbrot set. Each piece is individually numbered and is a one-off perspective, a different location, a different magnification. If you'd like us to send you one, find out more in the link we've included below.
Approximating pi in the Mandelbrot set. Maybe it's best to do a little bit of a reminder about what the Mandelbrot set is. So remember, the Mandelbrot set was this object that we have in the complex planes. So here are the real numbers, and here are imaginary numbers. And the Mandelbrot set was a collection of complex numbers. So I'll try and sort of draw a nice version of this here.